How was the experience?
So the experience was wonderful. Like, I learned a lot there, especially going into a new education system, which is mostly based on rigorous assignments and practical approach. So the experience was like once in a lifetime, I would say.
So do you think systems here in India are not that good?
Sir, I believe we could improve a lot, the systems in India. Like, when I compare both my experiences in the US as well as in India, I feel that we can have more of a research ecosystem as well as industrial collaborations, which can be beneficial for not only the students, but also for the private players.
And your experience working there, some energy lab you worked?
Yes, sir.
How was that experience?
So that experience was also very nice, and it was actually during this experience that I decided to pursue civil services, because I was working as a policy researcher and I was working in close interaction with civil servants both from US Department of Energy as well as India's Ministry of Power.
India's Ministry of
Power?
Power.
Yes, sir.
How that was?
NREL was working on a project called Greening the Grid, wherein we were studying increasing penetrations of renewables in our India's electric grid. So by that project, I was interacting with some of the civil servants from India.
Tell me four good points of India and four good points of US, and then your decision to which country you should be living in.
Sir, with respect to India, I believe our cultural heritage is one of the most important things which we have. Secondly, sir, is our tolerance with respect to different systems which we have in the country. So I believe that is also an important thing.
Can you explain what is tolerance?
Yes, sir. Sir, we have tolerance towards different types of cultures, different religions, as well as different systems, both public as well as private.
It is missing there in US?
Yes, sir. It is missing to a certain extent.
Racialism is there.
Yes, sir. Sir, the third thing which I would say is with respect to our economic ecosystem. For example, sir, we are the ones who try and save for our future generations and are not consumerist in approach. So I believe that that is something which we can have. And sir, I also feel that the spiritualism which exists in India is something that is not seen on the same level in US. And I believe that on that level, we are much more calm and composed. And I believe we are much more engaging with the outside world. So, and with respect to the US, sir, the four things which I would mention is, first is their professionalism. The ability to maintain a work-life balance, as well as their ability to say no. Second, sir, I would say is there, the people there, they do small talks with anyone irrespective of their occupation. And I believe that that should be something that can be adopted by us.
They don't waste time.
So not only wasting time, but if someone is passing by, he'll just ask you like, hey, how are you? And that just brightens up your day to a certain extent. Thirdly, sir, I would believe is, their ability to follow up with the tasks which is given to them. That is something very important, I believe. And finally, sir, I would say that their ability to invest time in their personal self is something that we can adopt from them. Because they try to spend time not only to develop their skills, but also to be small things like going to the gym or going out on cycling, having a weekend off. So these things, I believe, that ensure that more happiness in a person's life.
Where do you like to stay?
Sir, I would prefer to stay in India because I have my roots in India. My family is in India, and the decision which I took after living 3 years in the US when I had a stable lifestyle is something, is the reason because of which I will recommend staying in India.
As far as work-life balance is concerned, I think it is not true for Indians living there in US. They again work much more than the requirement. It may be true for the Americans that they work 9 to 5 only, but not the Indian ones.
Sir, I beg to differ a little bit on this. In the student life, we have a lot of work because we are usually working 13 to 14 hours every day. We have the schoolwork as well as part-time jobs to sustain our livelihoods. But once you go into a full-time job, since you're already earning, so you usually have a 9-to-5 work-life balance.
You know about the Supreme Court functioning here and there?
Sir, I know about our Supreme Court, but I have limited knowledge. I do have some, but limited.
What? What? How many judges will be there? How many judges here? Any rough idea?
Sir, in India we have 34 judges in the Supreme Court. I'm not sure about the number.
9 judges.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
This Anna Hazare.
Yes, sir.
Recently news.
Yes, sir. Sir, Anna Hazare is a role model in the Raligaon Siddhi village of Ahmednagar district, and he has been very influential with respect to turning a drought-prone district into a water-sufficient district.
Now, and he was in news very recently, 3-4 days back, somewhere. He was going on fast. Why temples are closed? Temples should also be open or something.
I'm sorry, sir. I haven't heard about it.
Okay, Hivre Bazaar.
Yes, sir. Sir, Hivre Bazaar is again a model village in the district of Ahmednagar, and the sarpanch, Mr. Popatrao Pawar, has efficiently used the PRI system to transform their village again into a self-sufficient and a multi-millionaire village in their district. So it is based on the concept of collective work as well as water budgeting and formation of cooperatives in different sectors. So just to state an example, they also have a cooperative Mangal Karyalay wherein people can conduct their marriages at minimal costs. And they have also focused on dairy cooperatives, which has helped improve the incomes of the people living in that village.
Vinayak.
Yes, sir.
You were just pulled out of Afghanistan. Was there some issues in the way you pulled out? Was it unplanned? What do you think?
So I believe that the pullout was a very hasty process. It could have been done in a better manner, wherein it could have put conditions on the Taliban, as well as it could have put conditions on Taliban to ensure a shared government, as well as upholding of human rights and female rights. So from my point of view, it was a hasty withdrawal.
Okay. US has left a lot of resources in Afghanistan.
Yes.
A lot of aeroplanes. They have said they have decommissioned it, or they've used some term. What would they have done to these what do you call equipments?
Sir, some of these systems, they have communication devices through which they are able to operate in a better way. I believe they would have basically decommissioned those devices, as well as there is a lot of mechatronics involved in these devices. So I believe they might have disrupted the circuits which for their efficient function.
Okay. Taliban has said that China is its most important partner. What is its implication for India?
So we see that there is a new axis of China, Pakistan and Afghanistan developing. And I believe that the Taliban saying that China is one of its important partners, it is basically, it can cause security concerns to us, because China would try to have its BRI infrastructure in Afghanistan, and Pakistan, being in middle of India and Afghanistan, it will try to restrain our connections with Taliban. So I feel that it is going to be a security concern for us.
Can you explain India's current renewable energy basket, and what kind of changes can we expect in the next 10 years?
Sir, currently our basket consists of around 40 gigawatts of solar, around 38 to 39 gigawatts of wind, 5 gigawatts of small hydro, and around 10 gigawatts of biomass. These are installed capacities in the electric sector. Sir, by 2022, we will be having around 175 gigawatts of installed solar capacity, and by 2030, we will be having 450 gigawatts. And as a result, as we are increasing the penetration of renewables, we will have to also depend on storage systems. And these storage systems will be in the form of grid level storage, as well as gravity storage systems like pumped hydros. Also, sir, I also believe that with the penetration of renewables, we would have to diversify the locations of these renewables. So currently, our renewable setup is mostly in the west and the south. And going towards 2030, we'll have to have this setup also in the east and the north.
Okay. I'm reading about something called as a global chip shortage. Are you aware of this?
Yes, sir.
Why is it happening, and what are the main sectors which will be affected by this?
Sir, this is happening because of the supply chain breakage which occurred because of the COVID pandemic, and there was disruptions because the movement of these products were limited, as well as the manufacturing was stopped due to lockdowns. Sir, the most important sectors which currently is getting affected is automobiles, but there are also other sectors
like electronics industry, the computer, the software industry, which is getting affected because of this.
Okay. We have green hydrogen.
Yes.
That is the news. You have electric vehicles and you have IC engines. Can you tell me the difference between the functioning or engines of these three different types of vehicles?
So, for green hydrogen, we have a fuel cell system wherein we can fill in the fuel from outside. Although it is said that it is convenient to fill that, but hydrogen being explosive, it needs to operate in a very secured manner. So this will be basically a fuel cell system, which will be the excrete products of this system will be water and heat. With respect to the electric vehicles, it will be operated by an electric motor, and this will be powered by an electric battery. With respect to an IC engine vehicle, sir, it is basically an SI engine or a compressed the SI engine or the diesel engine or the compressed engine. In this, we have a fuel which is either self-igniting or which is ignited by a spark plug. So it is powered by the heat energy which is generated, which is transferred by the connecting rod.
So,
Vinay,
this is an IDE, right?
Yes.
Columbia. And you went on scholarship, or was it without scholarship?
Ma'am, I had 15% of scholarship.
Still, it is very, very expensive.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, it's one of the most expensive universities in US. So, after having spent so much, then still, you know, you decided to come back. So, don't you think it's too late in the day to take this call? You know, you could have done your post-graduation from here also.
Ma'am, the exposure which I got during the master's as well as my full-time job, as I previously mentioned, I was interacting with some civil servants, and during this time I realized, ma'am, that the research which is done by the scientists, it will remain only on paper unless it is implemented on the ground level by the civil servants. And I thought I could be a good interlocutor, because by that time I had decided that I wanted to go into policy making. And when I looked into the career trajectory of a civil servant in India, the first half deals with policy implementation and stakeholder management, and the second half goes into policy making.
I understand what you're trying to say here. My question is very, very different. It's to do with, you know, the right timing of making the right kind of career choice. So maybe, you know, you can afford, but not everyone can afford to have spending, you know, so much of money on post-grad and then coming back here. So are we somewhere lacking in a system, in education system, where we are not able to support and help make children take the right career choices at the right time?
Ma'am, to answer your first question with respect to the affordability, I was able to repay most of my loans with respect to the job which I had in the US. And to answer your second question with respect to the timings of the decision, the fact that we have age limits for UPSC up to 32 years, as well as for different organizations, we have a maximum age limit. I believe that it itself tells us that we are asking the students to get exposure and then make a career choice. Because a lot of students, even after going to engineering, they try and explore in different fields like MBAs or directly into civil services. So I feel that this is the right ecosystem, because we are allowing the children to explore and then find the area of their interest.
Okay. Any notable alumni from your university who inspires you?
Ma'am, there are many. To note a couple of them is Sir Vishwasaraya, after whom we celebrate the Engineers Day. And ma'am, also Rajiv Bajaj, who is the CEO of the Bajaj company.
In Colombia.
This is from CEO.
Yeah, in Colombia, ma'am.
In Colombia, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar and Bhupen Hazarika are the two. No.
Okay. And what is your view on brain drain? How can we address this?
Ma'am, to see why brain drain is occurring, there are two major issues which exist. One is people go from India to outside countries in the search for better quality education as well as better standard of living through better job opportunities. So to address these things, firstly to deal with the educational attainment, I believe that we should focus on a research-based ecosystem in India, wherein students have much more flexibility in choosing their courses, as well as there is interdisciplinary approach. And ma'am, to address the second question with respect to job opportunities and standard of living, I believe that we have a great potential for the creation of entrepreneurs. And if we are able to tap in these resources with the recent initiatives we are taking, like opening up of the defense and the space sectors, as well as entrepreneur the support schemes like Stand Up India, I feel that this is the right way to go. And we can also try and ensure that these startups, they become unicorns rather than staying dwarf. So this is the approach IPTV.
You're reading newspapers?
Yes, ma'am.
And US was in news. It's in news right now. For what reasons?
Ma'am, one of the reasons is Afghanistan.
Just new news in the last 1 or 2 days.
Yesterday, there was a news in Texas wherein they had passed a law on anti-abortion.
Anything to do with climate change?
Yes, ma'am. The John Perry.
Any floods? Anything?
Yes, ma'am. There was Cyclone Ida in the northeast.
Why is it in news?
Ma'am, this is one of the strongest cyclones. Especially in New York, it has caused a rain of 3 inches, and which is one of the maximum.
Any deaths?
There were around 45 to 50 deaths, ma'am, but I'm not sure on the exact.
And what do you think? What is the reason for this? Flooding.
Ma'am, there are multiple reasons. The basic ones, which include that the cyclones are because of the rising sea surface temperatures. But the extreme events of these cyclones is also because of global warming. With rising temperatures of air, the air is able to hold more moisture and it is pouring down.
Is it known that this is because of global warming this spread has happened?
The increase in number, the frequency of these events is basically, according to even the recent IPCC report, it has said that a major cause of it is global warming.
One last question.
Yes.
This is about Maharashtra. So, again, it is in news that BJP and MNS is demanding to open temples in Maharashtra. So, what is your view?
Ma'am, I personally believe that the temples should not be opened, because right now we are having cases of the order of 4,000 to 5,000 per day.
They are saying you can open liquor shops, and why not temples?
Ma'am, liquor shops, they right now in most of the cities, they are operating on a token-based basis. So there is not crowding in these shops. A token is raised and then the delivery is made. As well as the liquor shops also help the state to generate incomes or revenues. Some of which it is losing because of the lockdowns. But with respect to religious places, ma'am, there is a lot of crowding in these cases.
You can also implement token system or something of that sort in temples also and can open it.
Ma'am, but with respect to the liquor shops, the amount of population or the percentage of population which has access to liquor is much smaller as opposed to people who want to go to the temples. So, in that sense, I believe that it is best interest of everyone to keep it closed. Thank you.
You are from Pune.
Yes, sir, I did my engineering in Pune.
You did your engineering in Pune, but you are from Maharashtra.
Yes, sir.
Tell me something about Peshwa Bajirao.
Sir, Bajirao Peshwa first, he was one of the prominent establishers of the Peshwa dynasty which existed. And then he also ensured that all the different sects of Maratha communities, like the Sindhias, Bhosles, they were working in coordination rather than opposing each other. And sir, he was also expansionist and one of the prominent leaders. It is said that he took his kingdom from Attak to Matak. Attak is in Afghanistan and Matak is in South India. So he is basically a great leader from the Peshwa dynasty.
And he's credited with, as you said, expanding the boundaries of Maratha Empire. So at its peak, what were the how much region of India did the Maratha Empire cover?
Sir, I would say the current geographical area in terms of that, around 60 to 65% of the area was covered by Bajirao Peshwa.
Okay. Vinayak, you have graduated from Columbia University. Recently, last year during the Black Lives Matter movement, we saw that many statues were dismantled. Confederate statues and also some statues in UK as well. So, do you think it is a logical trend? I mean, history should be left as it is so that people should know about what those personalities have done. And they should interpret, people should interpret themselves. Do you think bringing down those statues is logical?
Sir, I don't believe that bringing those statues is logical. And I believe that this is more of the work of small marginal sections who are miscreants and who are trying to promote violence in such cases or try to instigate that feeling of racial discrimination among the masses. So this is more of a symbolic nature, and there should be more rules and regulations to deter such people from doing such acts.
Okay. And tell me that why Silicon Valley is different from rest of the world in terms of its encouragement to entrepreneurship. What is so special about Silicon Valley?
Sir, I don't have exact knowledge about it, but I believe that the incubation centers as well as the interdisciplinary approach which is seen in this ecosystem of Silicon Valley is something that promotes the entrepreneurs to go there and set up their businesses, because they also get a lot of mentorship from the extant entrepreneurs. So that is also another reason.
Okay. You have worked for some time in the renewable energy laboratory. So can you tell me what is the status of adoption of rooftop solar in India?
So currently it is very low. It is of the order of 4 gigawatts, and out of which around 2.5 to 3 gigawatts exist in 3 states of Maharashtra, Gujarat and Karnataka. So a lot needs to be done in this scenario, because we are targeting around 40 gigawatts by 2022.
Okay, and which country is the world leader in rooftop solar?
I am not aware, sir.
Okay. You have also mentioned watching English TV series as one of your hobbies. So what is the last TV series that you have seen?
Sir, I saw Genius of Albert Einstein, and prior to that I saw Chernobyl. These were the two.
Okay. So as you saw Chernobyl, there were a lot of after effects of the blast that happened there. So, do you think as a renewable energy option, nuclear energy is really sustainable? Because the per unit cost of nuclear energy is quite high as compared to solar or wind energy. So, do you think why governments are actually investing in nuclear energy? The waste material is also volatile to handle. So, why are they interested in it?
Sir, to answer your first question with respect to my opinion, I believe that the green energy in terms of solar and wind should be the future, because as you rightly pointed out, that it is very expensive to set up a nuclear power plant, as well as it has toxic wastes which are generated. And if we look per megawatt or per unit prices, nuclear somewhere costs around 6 rupees per unit, whereas solar is costing right now 2 rupees. So I believe that green energy is the future. And sir, worldwide we are seeing a decrease in nuclear installments, especially after the Fukushima disaster which occurred in Japan. The almost every another plant of nuclear is currently established in China, and in India also we have only 7 gigawatts of capacity, which is less than 2% of our installed capacity. So I believe that world over there is a decrease in installation of nuclear power plants rather than people looking forward to invest in it.